Come. to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end."
Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who is said to be unable to conceive in her sixth month, for no word from God will ever fail. "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." And the angel left her.
Said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save the people from their sins.
All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus.
In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Cyrenius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available.
Movie. I made a confession this past Sunday at Lakeshore. Some of you here know, you were here Sunday morning and you heard me say this. I had to turn in my man card. I like Hallmark Christmas movies. And I know how they're going to end. I know what's going to happen. I can tell you as soon as all the characters are introduced, who's going to fall in love with who, who's going to not go ahead and continue a relationship with the other one, who's going to stay in the small town instead of going back to the big city. I know the whole story. And sometimes we've heard the Christmas story so many times that we can think of it like a Hallmark movie. Another nice story. We know how it goes. I want to read a little bit more of it from Luke chapter 2. In Luke's gospel, beginning with verse 8, it says this. There were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You'll find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest. On earth, peace to men on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. An amazing story. A story that was foretold hundreds of years before it happened. Through the prophets, God had given some hints, some even detailed events that were going to happen that would lead into the coming of the Messiah, and all these things will take place, just as the prophets had said. And now on that hillside, there are these shepherds that are taking care of their flocks. They're just at work doing what they normally do, and all of a sudden an angel appears to them, and it says they were terrified. And in the original language, the word translated terrified really means, I'm just to show you how deep I am in the Greek language, it means terrified. They were scared. They were shaking. You see, they didn't know what it meant when an angel appeared to them. They were afraid maybe it was some kind of sign from God that they were being judged, or they were going to be maybe struck dead. There was going to be some kind of... They didn't know what was about to happen. So the first thing the angel says is, "Don't be afraid." That's the first thing I want to hear. An angel appeared to me all of a sudden. The angel says, "Don't be afraid." And the angel says, "I bring you," this is the best thing they could hear, "I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all of you." I know the Hallmark movies are beautiful and they're great stories. They talk about things like love for family and goodwill toward men, and all those things are good and they're centered in God's word. But what the story here we're celebrating tonight is all about is more than that. You see, this baby that they put in that manger, that was God. That was God come to us in the flesh. That was God clothing himself in human flesh because he came here to fulfill his plan to reconcile all of the world back to him again. You see, we had separated ourselves from God by our sin. God's a holy God, a pure God, and you cannot be in the presence of God with your sin, neither can I. So there needed to be a cure. There needed to be an answer for our sin. And God didn't just send us a good story. He didn't just send us some message. He came himself to make the payment that had to be made for our sin. That's the only way we could be with him forever. And more than anything else, God wants you, he wants me, be with him forever. You see, too many people today are running from God because they don't understand that what God wants more than anything is for you to be able to stay with him forever. And he wants that so much that he came here personally to provide the way for you to do that, the way for me
to do that. It's been said many times, and it's true, the shadow of the cross was already on the manger in Bethlehem when they put the baby there. You see, the plan was already set. The prophets had already spoken. God had already set the course of events in motion that would lead that baby to grow up without sin, to be rejected by his own, to be beaten and spit on and nailed to a cross. So tonight, as we get ready to celebrate Christmas and all the fun and the traditions, and it should be a glorious time that we celebrate, I want us to pause and remember the purpose for it all. We're going to have a time of having communion together, as we traditionally do for our candlelight service here. And I'm going to ask those who are going to serve, Pastor Praise, to go ahead and get up and take your place and get ready. I'm going to lead us in a word of prayer, but as an example of the past, it's free for all to partake. If you choose to partake, we want to encourage you to do that. But I want you to take the bread and hold it when it's passed, and take the cup of juice and hold it when it's passed, until I lead us, and we'll all take it together at the same time. Let's pray again. Father, we thank you that we can come here tonight, we can sing and we can celebrate, and it is a marvelous story. But the story includes something really hard that had to happen. And now we pause to remember that what had to happen to us, that payment that had to be made for sin. And the baby whose birthday we celebrate is the one who grew up to pay that price. So Father, please help us to focus now as these emblems are passed, and really remember the sacrifice that was made. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Apostle Paul records for us in 1 Corinthians 11. We give in verse 23. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." He continued, "In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me.'" Then Paul added these words, "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." In other words, we've been given a responsibility. If we believe in Jesus, that baby grew up, that he taught us how to live, that he set the example to follow. If we believe that he was nailed to that cross, but that he rose again and conquered death on the third day, that he's gone back to the Father and he's waiting to come back and take us to be with him. If we believe that about Jesus, then we have been given the responsibility of proclaiming Jesus to the world. In fact, on one occasion, when Jesus himself was teaching in the Beatitudes, in the Sermon on the Mount, he said in Matthew 5, beginning in verse 14, "You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden." He said to do this. Instead, he said, "Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven." We have a responsibility, not just at Christmas, but all year long, to shine our lights for Jesus. Jesus said in Matthew 9, "While I'm in the world, I'm the light of the world." But now he's gone back to the Father. And he says, "Now you need to be that light for the world." And one of the best ways we choose to remember that and to celebrate that is by the lighting of the candles in our candlelight service at Christmas. And so at this time, we're going to have some who have been designated to come and get lighters. I want you to get your candles out and grab mine. I'm going to give you a little fire safety instruction. We don't want to burn anything down tonight. Take your candle and slide the cup down so that you can see the way along the top here. And what we're going to ask some of our candle lighters to do is they're going to light, starting at the corners, at the end of each aisle, they're going to go down and light the candle of the person sitting on the aisle. But here's what we're supposed to do, right? We're supposed to share that light with others. So they're going to turn and light the next person, and then they're going to turn and light the next person's candle until all of our candles are lit and all of our lights are shining. Let's pray. Father, as we light these candles tonight, may we be reminded of your call to us, that you came to be the light of the world to show us the way, but now, Father, you've given us that awesome privilege and responsibility to be that light for you. As we light these candles tonight, may they represent our lives and our willingness to commit to shining our light, to honor Jesus and draw people to him. It's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Precious promise, Son of God and Son of Man.
you join me? Stand up with me as we sing together Silent Night.
Jesus on his birthday. And Father, we just pray that as we leave this place, We were no more shining your light brightly, because you promised that if we would lift Jesus up to the world, he will draw all men to him. Father, we pray that you would use us for your glory and honor
and bringing people to Jesus.
In whose name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Merry Christmas, everybody.